at the Sandhill Research and Education Center outside Columbia. I'm speaking with TJ Savereno, who's a natural resources agent with Clemson. TJ, this is a research plot that you've put in that's related to the interest that people now have in longleaf pine restoration, particularly as it relates to habitat. So let's talk about why that became an important topic and how this fits in the overall scheme of things.
Well, absolutely. The longleaf ecosystem used to be the dominant upland ecosystem in the southeast from Virginia all the way to eastern Texas. It covered about 93 million acres in its height, but now we only have about 3 million acres of it left. And there's been a lot of effort in the past 20, 30 years in trying to bring back the longleaf pine ecosystem, and not just growing the trees, but growing all the species that are associated with it.
A lot of people look at pine forest and they think there's nothing there, but apparently, when properly managed, it's incredibly rich.
It is. It's one of the most diverse, especially longleaf ecosystems, one of the most diverse ecosystems in the world, rivaling the rainforests. In some experimental plots, there have been documented as many as 40 different species of plants in a square meter area.
Which is not very big.
Not very big.
But all this is dependent on a natural phenomenon.
That's correct. It's dependent on fire or some type of disturbance that sets back succession and keeps it in an early successional stage.
So what we want is to have the trees, but then in order to have habitat for quail, for small birds, for mammals, for reptiles, for amphibians, and for pollinators, for insects, we don't want to have a big shrubby, woody layer.
Exactly. The longleaf ecosystem evolved over millions of years with fire as a regular disturbance, probably every 2 to 3 years, which would keep those woody species out, but promote a herbaceous understory of the things that we see around us here. A lot of grasses, a lot of legumes, and a lot of the composites or the aster species.
Okay, so what are we doing here on this spot?
Well, this is one of our study plots, the only one remaining actually, of the South Carolina longleaf ground cover common garden study. That's a mouthful. But it's a collaborative project that we entered into, that Clemson University entered into with the U.S. Forest Service because of their interest in restoring the longleaf habitat.
If I can give a synopsis of what you explained to me, there weren't great sources to get seed for this that related to South Carolina necessarily, or the different parts of South Carolina. So y'all gathered seed from native situations in several states and brought them in, and you've planted them in randomized plots, making sure that, you know, nobody's getting any preferential treatment. And you're going back and you're studying everything to see which ones are best adapted for us.
That's correct. Early on, a lot of the seed that was available was coming from some of the big suppliers out in the Midwest or in the Southwest and various places around the country. And we know from an ecological standpoint that those probably were not the best sources of plant material to use in the Southeast and to restore longleaf ground cover. So the purpose of these studies is to identify how far plant material should be moved to ensure the success of habitat restoration projects.
And some of the things you look at are biomass, like how thick it is and what nutrients are in it.
Some of it has to do with that, the chemistry of the plant. A lot of it has to do with what we refer to as the phenology, the sequence of timing for things like when the first leaves appear, when the flowering stalk starts to grow, when the flowers open up, when the seed is set, things like that. So it's all about timing, which is important to how successful a plant may perform.
You said just like with peaches, if we get a late frost, if a plant puts its flowers on too early, it may not get to set seed.
Correct.
And so there's a lot to look at and take into account.
Right. Yes.
Well, let's talk about the actual plants that are here, and we'll start with the legumes.
Okay.
And so why are legumes important, and which ones are we growing?
Okay, well, as you mentioned, we have several different major groups here. We have the legumes, the grasses, and the composite species. The legumes are extremely important especially in the sandier, poorer soils, like here in the Sandhills, where there aren't that many nutrients in the soil. The legumes are able to come in where other plants can't survive because they're able to take atmospheric nitrogen and fix it and to supply their own needs for nitrogen. And beyond that, they also produce very high protein seeds, very hard coated seeds that are persistent throughout the year. And those are very important foods for a lot of wildlife species, such as the northern bobwhite quail. A lot of their diet in the wintertime consists of these legume seeds.
Because they last a long time, so they're there when everything else is gone.
When everything else has been eaten up, these seeds are still around.
And we have that group represented by which two plants?
We have that represented by Tephrosia virginiana. The common name is goat's rue. And we also have it, Lespediza capitata, which is the roundhead Lespediza.
And that's a native one. The goat's rue is kind of sprawly and vine-like, and the Lespediza is very upright.
It is upright, yes.
All right. And then we have the composites, which are the things that look like daisies or in the aster family.
Right.
Some of them look like daisies.
Yes, some of them look like daisies. Some of them look like this goldenrod that we see behind us. But they are all in the aster family, the composite, which have very specific characteristics. And they are important because they are very, they produce a lot of nectar. They're very attractive to pollinators. And as you know, we are having, we have a lot of concern now because of the loss of native pollinator species. A lot of people know about honeybees, but a lot of people don't realize that there are a lot of native bees out there, flies, beetles, butterflies, moths, that play an important part in pollinating our food crops and in wild plants as well that wildlife depend on.
And when we bring the pollinators in, we not only are supplying habitat to pollinators, but a lot of things like to eat pollinators.
Exactly. For example, the bobwhite quail, when they first hatch out, they have a very high protein requirement, and insects are full of protein. So it's beneficial to them if once they come out and hatch and start following mama around, that they're able to find these high protein food sources like insects.
And then you mentioned the quail, and the grasses that we have that grow traditionally are bunch grasses. And you said that's real different from like turf grasses, that bunch grass is very important for habitat.
Yes, we're standing in some little bluestem plants right here. And the native warm season grasses, we refer to them as, one of the characteristics is that they are bunch grasses, which means that they start from a small base, but they spread out toward the top. The important thing about that for wildlife, quail, small mammals, is that there's a lot of bare ground that facilitates them moving around and finding their food sources. But if there's an aerial predator or some type of other predator that comes in, they have a little place where they can tuck underneath there and hide and get the cover that they need to escape.
And then one of the others that looks a little smaller as we look at it today is one of the sorgastrums?
It's a sorgastrum or one of the Indian grasses. Mm-hmm. A lot of people are familiar with yellow Indian grass, which is our state grass, but this one is a little different. It's called nodding Indian grass or Elliott's Indian grass. It's got a beautiful leaning inflorescence, and so it's a little different from the yellow Indian grass, but we have that here also.
And then the grass that most people have heard of in association with the longleaf community is the wiregrass, Aristida, is that correct?
Aristida, and we have two species of Aristida in our garden here. One is the northern species, which is Aristida stricta, and the southern species, Aristida brickiana, which covers most of the coast of South Carolina, except for a little gap. And in that gap, which we refer to as the bluestem gap, things like little bluestem and Andropogon virginicus, the broom sedge, some of those bluestems fill that function of wiregrass does in the other places.
In addition to producing seeds that can be used by the wildlife, you said the grasses are very important because of that fire dependency.
Exactly. For fire to be able to carry through these ecosystems, you need the fuel. And you need fine, flashy fuel that will burn readily and continuously across the landscape. In a longleaf stand that has a lot of trees in it, there's a lot of pine straw that helps to serve that purpose. But in some of these natural longleaf systems, there are very sparse trees out there, so there's not a lot of pine straw. And those grasses help to carry that fire that that ecosystem is really dependent on.
And y'all actually, with the Aristida, with the wiregrass, put 50-gallon drums on top of it and burn some of it to see how it responded.
Right. One of the treatments that we did out here to look at the effects on the wiregrass was to do some burning of individual plants at different times of the year. And Cody Bishop, that works here, helped to craft a burn container or a burn chamber out of a 55-gallon drum. And we put it around each individual plant and actually burned those plants. Sometimes we added a little bit of pine straw to help get the fire started.
And you said that wiregrass, over the millions of years of coevolution, it actually itself became kind of dependent on fire.
That's correct. Wiregrass really is dependent on the fire to help it to produce flowers and to set seed. And one of the reasons that we did our experiment is to see exactly what time of year is most beneficial to wiregrass in terms of its producing flowering stalks and producing flowers and setting seed.
I think it's really exciting that people are beginning to understand the importance of prescribed burns and not be afraid of them, and to see how remarkably important it is for habitat to continue and have the things it needs. So we applaud you for this, because I think it's going to make our landowners more successful when they go in and spend all this money putting these plots in. If people would like to come out and wander around and see this area, is that allowed?
Yes, the Sandhill Rec is one of the most public friendly of our research and education centers. There's a lot of public use of the land here, and people come out here on the walking trails and walk their dogs, and you're welcome to come in. To ask that you don't step on plants if you can avoid it, but to come in and look at our plants and to ask questions through your local extension office, or have them put you in touch with me, and I'll be glad to answer any questions people may have.
TJ, this is a very exciting project. Thank you so much for sharing your
information. Thank you, Amanda, for giving me the opportunity.